Ki tetze. The most critical question in human relationships. How does one approach the other? The person who is different from oneself. Someone who is similar to you. Obviously, it's important to love, and not so difficult to love. But what about someone who is other? The most important and commanding verse in this sense is in the book of Exodus, V'ahavtem et hager, you must love the stranger, the other. Kigeirim hayitem be'eretz Mitzrayim, because you were strangers in the land of Egypt. You know what it is to be considered other and hated as a result of it. And hence, in our portion, Deuteronomy 23, verse 8, Lo titaev Mitzri, you shall not hate an Egyptian. Kiger hayita ba'artzo, because you were a stranger in their land. Don't take revenge. Learn the opposite. To try to love your enemy, obviously, as long as he shows that he no longer destroys people who are other, then you have to hate him. The real test about other comes a bit later on in the portion. Chapter 23, verse 16. Lo tazkir eved el adonav. If a runaway slave comes to be helped by you, if you look at Targum Onkelos, it's a Gentile slave owned by a Gentile person, it would seem outside of the land of Israel. And the Gentile slave runs to you for help and aid. You dare not give him away, give him back to his original Gentile owner who is apparently mistreating him. Verse 17. Imchayeshev, he must dwell with you. Bekir b'cha, in your midst. B'makom asher yivchar, in the place where he shall choose to live. Be'achad sha'arecha, in any one of your gates. Batovlo, which is good for him. Lo tonenu, do not oppress him. I remember when I first studied this verse, I thought to myself, why does the Bible talk so much? In the place where he chooses to live, in one of your gates, any one of your cities, with you shall he dwell, in your midst, in a place which is good for him. Why talk so much? And then I studied American history. And it's very, very fascinating that it was in 1896 that there was the very famous Plessy versus Ferguson case before the Supreme Court. And as late as 1896, the Supreme Court decided that African Americans, blacks, who were then slaves, those African Americans could be forced to live in separate areas and go to separate schools as long as they were separate and equal. It wasn't until Brown versus the Board of Education in 1954, the Court of Justice Earl Warren, who was then the Chief Justice, when Plessy versus Ferguson was overturned and the decision was separate but equal, takes away human rights. Human rights means that an individual has the right to live anywhere he wishes to live. Maimonides rules in Laws of Idolatry, chapter 10, that anyone who accepts upon himself the 7 Noahide laws of morality may live in the land of Israel. He just has to be moral. One of the laws of morality is not necessarily believing in God. He doesn't have to believe in God. He can't murder. He can't steal. He can't commit adultery. He can't eat the limb or blood of a living animal. He can't blaspheme God. He cannot serve idols, which means the evil acts which surround idolatry, like sacrificing your child to Moloch. And he has to establish law courts to see to it that these other 6 laws are maintained. But as long as he is living as a moral being, he can live within Israel. And the Bible teaches us how he must be able to live in Israel. A runaway slave comes to you for succor. Don't give him back to his previous owner. He was being mistreated. The Bible is against slavery. Here's where you see it very, very clearly. And where do you give him a place to live? Imcha yeshev, he must live with you, in your midst. The place that he will choose in any one of your cities, a place which is good for him. Lo tonenu, don't oppress him. If you make him live in a specific area, go to a specific school with only people like himself, that would be considered oppression. So the Bible was 4,000 years ahead of its time. Would that we would learn from the Bible how to accept other properly. Shabbat Shalom.